everybody. This is Dan, and this is the desktop lecture for the second week of class. And you've noticed with these videos, usually I try to put a little bit of music in the beginning and the music in the end. I hope you can tolerate that. It's just something that I've always done. I used to play music in class while people were coming into the classroom, and the habit just sort of stuck when I started producing these desktop lectures, because to me, these lectures are sort of like the classroom. I have a thirst to lecture, to talk. I like to talk. So that's why I do these, and also hopefully so you can get a feel for the assignment and get to know me a little bit better every week. Something I want to talk about this week before I get into the readings is something that came up on our introduction discussion post, which I appreciated. And Irma, if it's Irma or Irma, mentioned her desire to use the history that she learns in this class in everyday life. And I thought about that, so I kind of came up with this idea of applied business history. And what I'm talking about is sometimes it's difficult when we're in school to learn how we're going to actually apply what we learn, or, you know, how can I use what I learn in school? And it's especially difficult in the humanities, you know, in history, because it's interesting and it helps you understand who you are, but it's not always something we can apply in our daily lives. And when I started to teach, you know, sort of general American history, I always told students that they could apply what they've learned in history by trying to eliminate, you know, prejudice and hate from their lives and live a life of compassion. And, you know, it might sound a little corny to some of you, but it's not always easy to do. But you know, I think that because of our culture, sometimes we're pre-programmed by society to deal with, you know, issues of race and issues of gender and religion in unbecoming ways, if you will. And for some of us, this manifests itself in hate or in prejudice towards others. And, you know, history is full of wars and full of inequities and full of riots and full of hate. And in a sense, it sometimes can be like the evening news, that the more bad news comes out in history than good news. It's not always the case, but it's often that way. So, you know, I always told my students in general history classes that if they wanted to apply the history that they used, you know, the best thing to do was to understand others. And because most all bad historical disasters, if they're not natural disasters, have some roots in hate and misunderstanding. So, you know, on sort of a micro level, I always felt like if we were kind to each other on a daily basis, that in effect was applied history. It could be as easy as, you know, holding open a door for somebody and just trying to understand someone else's point of view. So, you know, I know that might sound a little silly to some of you, but it's sort of the way I look at things. And if I can't make sense out of what I'm doing trying to teach history, then, you know, it gets pretty depressing. I feel like it's a waste of my time. So back to this notion of Irma and applied business history, you know, the one thing we'll learn about the history of business in America is that there's a lot of exploitation of the land, exploitation of natural resources, and also of people. And this is all in the name of capitalism and making a profit. It's the nature of the free market and capitalism that greed and gain seem to be the natural course of things. And I tend to believe that moral capitalism can be achieved, or at least practiced, through responsible use of resources, respect for the environment, and respect for workers. So one of the ways I think you can apply the history of business that we learn over the course of the semester is to do business locally when possible, to do business with responsible companies. And for you business majors out there, you know, don't turn into an evil entrepreneur who puts profit ahead of people, or profits ahead of the earth. So that's sort of a way you can apply what we learn here. I'm not saying that, you know, all corporations or capitalism is bad. I like the free market setup, and I think that you should be able to profit for your good ideas. And I often wonder which University of Toledo student is going to invent the next Facebook or the next Apple computer or figure out how to cure malaria or cure cancer. So, for those people who do succeed and do go on to create great things, and I'm sure someone in here will, maybe many of you, you should be rewarded, but not at the expense of others. So that's sort of my speech on, how we apply what we learn in class, being responsible business people or being also responsible consumers, buying local and supporting businesses that pay a fair wage and don't exploit the earth. So that's my little soapbox portion of the lecture. Getting into the readings today, there are two readings for this week coming up, and one is by a historian named Thomas McGraw, and the other one is by a gentleman, Thomas DiBacco. And they're both about the 1600s, and they address the time when the first Europeans came over to North America. And really, one of the reasons I picked these readings, especially the McGraw reading, is that he frames his reading around this idea that came from a historian named Carl Degler, and you don't need to remember the names. But Degler said about capitalism and North America or the United States that capitalism came to North America on the first ships, meaning that since the very beginning of the European invasion or European colonization, if you will, capitalism was part of the discourse. For the people that arrived in Jamestown down in the Roanoke area, they were interested in making profits from tobacco at the expense of workers and at the expense of slaves. For those up north, like from the Mayflower, the people landing in Plymouth or the Massachusetts Bay Company, they were interested in profits from land, land improvements, and profits from natural resources, in many cases at the expense of Native Americans. So really both of these readings address the early 1600s and sort of go back to the roots of capitalism. The McGraw reading is short. It's a web page, basically, but it gives you a nice overview of the period. And the DiBacco reading is a little longer. Actually, it's a scanned book, and there's two chapters scanned, but you only need to read the first chapter. If you want to read the second one, it's about Ben Franklin, and it's pretty interesting, but you don't have to do it for this class. So as you read through these chapters or these readings, you can pick up ideas on how religion played into capitalism and business, and really how this notion of freedom of religion, if you will, and doing good works is seen as part of God's divine plan, and so it relates to the pilgrims and their thoughts both about religion and about capitalism. So, capitalism in the 1600s is totally different than industrial capitalism or consumer-driven capitalism that we have today. But I want you to try to trace some roots of today's business environment back to the 1600s. I think that, as people studying history, we're really looking at how the past evolved to become the present. So, we're going back to the very beginning of European colonization in North America to try to get at the roots of capitalism, and we'll move forward. So both of these readings are, about the 1600s. Next week we'll jump up, 200 years to the beginnings of the United States. We'll talk about Alexander Hamilton and Thomas Jefferson, the great debates going on about, what the future of enterprise or business is in the country between those two. And then after that, we'll get into the early 1800s, the market revolution, and then the first industrial revolution in the U.S., which is, I think anyway, after the Civil War, with the rise of Carnegie and Rockefeller and the Gilded Age people. So that's what's happening. When you post about these readings, post something that you found interesting. I will give you some prompts on the discussion board, some questions you can consider answering. But, you know, anything that strikes you in the readings, you should talk about on the discussion board, because it's really an interesting period. And I think when we think about the history of business in America, you know, we think about modern business and industrialization and Walmarts and McDonald's and Apple Computer. But, you know, we need to go back to the beginning to see how this all started. So that's it for this week. I hope you have a great week and be safe, and I'll see you again next week. Thanks. Have a good day.
If you